Hey, my name is Ben. I teach you how to write Unity shaders from scratch. And today we are going to do a custom URP post effect. The post effect is actually very simple. It's just going to be a very basic screen tint, but it kind of goes over how we can actually add this custom post effect screen tint here, as well as set the different parameters here in order to set, you know, color and intensity. While this is a very simple effect, it is the baseline in how we can do future post effects in URP. Let's jump right into it. If you guys like what you see, please subscribe, like, and support my channel. All right, so the setup for this post effect is quite simple. As you can see, when we have a new scene, the materials here, but this global volume was here before. And what Unity has already added is a volume, a global volume. It has already added tone mapping for us, bloom, and vignette. And what we're going to do is we're going to add our own override onto this to create our own post effect. There's two scripts I've created. It's called the custom post effect screen tint, which is this one right here, tint render feature. So first we'll talk about this one. All it is a menu item. All it is going to be helping us create an area where we can tune this screen effect. It is a volume for menu in this render pipeline. If you put under tutorial and slash custom post screen tint, you'll see that it shows up here. Once you click override tutorial, and you'll see this here. Right now it has an error on iPost process component. This one of these inherited values, and the reason is because we haven't fully implemented everything that's inherited from this component. So let's go ahead and do that. So this video I will be moving a bit quicker than the previous ones, so I'll be cutting and copying a lot of stuff in. So as you can see, we just got rid of that error, that inherit error. What it is because we added is active, and we also added is tile compatible. Is active has to do with these check marks. I'll show you in a second. And is tile compatible? I'm actually not too sure what this one is. So let's move on. So to tint, we need two things. We need a public float. As you can see here, there are different types of variables. So we need one for float, and we need one for a color selector. So float parameter. It's equal to, let me just do new float parameter, and we'll do 1 as a default. Next thing we need is color. Let's just do color.white for now. Cool. Once we save that off, we should be able to add here, as you can see, under tutorial custom post screen tint, you see here, and we have our two colors. I think it didn't default to white is because I had this created before. Cool, let's go ahead and set up the rest of this. We're going to set up tint render feature. All right, so for this to work, we need two things. One, we need this scriptable render feature. That is adding a new render feature to our scriptable render pipeline. We also need a scriptable render pass. That will be our tint pass. Just think of it as, to me, I always think of a pass as one of these, like a bloom, a vignette is a pass, a tint is a pass, right? So we'll go ahead and create those. This is a new feature as well as a new pass. So the new pass, we'll just have to do a class tint pass, and we'll call it scriptable and inherit scriptable render pass. Okay, and then there's a couple of abstract classes we must implement. Let's just kind of do the autocomplete abstract classes, sorry, that we have to implement. So I always prefer, let's just implement this one as well. So this is executing. Executing is kind of like executing the pass, the buffer. You'll see that we'll be in here, we'll be creating render textures as well as information that we need to send to the command buffer as part of this pass. And up here, this is the render feature. This is just kind of adding which passes you want to do. So we'll be adding tint pass here, and create is, you know, the very first step. Okay, what we're going to create before we add to this pass. So all we really need to do is create a tint pass and add it to the render passes, right? Add it to the scriptable render. So I'll just show you how to do that right now. It's really, this part is actually quite simple. So we're just going to do private pass, private, let's call it tint pass, tint pass. And in our create, we will, instead of this, it will be tint pass is equal to new tint pass. Very simple. Here, instead of this throw exception, of course, we'll change it to render.inqueuePass, tint pass. That's it. I always feel like create should be first and then you add it to the pass. Just makes more sense to me like that. Okay, cool. And then now we'll work on the actual pass. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is create a new material for this tint pass. And I also have a shader that I have from a previous project. What it is because I called it custom post screen tint. And all it does is multiplies an overlay color on top of our main text, which is the source, multiplied by intensity. And we'll set up these two values and do our post effect. So first we need a material for this, so private. We also want a way to construct our tint pass. And in here, if there's no material, it doesn't exist, we'll just create a new material on the fly using custom post, using this as this shader. There's one more thing we can do here. That is, we want to set up a render pass event. This is a variable within scriptable render passes. And what it is it tells us when to actually, at what layer to actually send, do this pass. And we're going to do it before post-processing. All right, so the next thing we want to do is we want to do a before camera and after camera effect, right? So if I don't know if you guys remember in the previous post effects, what we would do is before, like on when the camera renders, do this, and then after it finishes, remove the render textures, right? So we always use render textures to, you know, pull it from the source, blit it to something, modify it, blit it back to the source, and then there's your post effect. And we're going to do something very similar using a lot of Unity's stuff here. So let's go ahead and, in fact, let's go to this and I will show you what's inside here if I can see it. All right, great. There's on camera setup. This is probably what we want. And on camera cleanup. Why don't we just copy these two over here? This is going to be an override. So we're going to do a public override on camera setup. It's a little messy, but bear with me. And then do the same thing for on camera cleanup. Done. And we don't need this configure. So setup, and then execute, and then cleanup. Maybe that makes more sense. So on camera setup, that is where we can do our creation of our render texture. But in this case, because we're in URP, it's not really called render texture. They have their own system called render target identifier. I do think of it as render textures though. So render target identifier, so we'll have a source and we'll have a tint. In order to create a new render target identifier for a tint, we also need a ID. So we'll call it tint ID. And we'll use our shader property ID to kind of generate an ID for us. And we'll just call it temp or something like that. Cool, that should be good. And then so on camera setup, to do our source, we need to get the source from the camera. So the camera data should be rendering data, camera data, camera color target, and our tint will be a new render target identifier. And what we need to do is pass in our ID. We might not actually have to. I'll leave this for now. Maybe we don't have to put this in here. Cool. We'll do that for now. And then in our execute, this is where we'll continue our setup. All right. So the first thing we need is to pull out our command buffer from our execute. So command buffer. We have a command buffer pool. And how we do it is we just do get. And we have to give it a name. And the name will be tint render feature. I'll disable this for now so we can still see this. Oh, I always have to remove it. Next, we need to get our volumes and we need to get our tint effect data, pretty much all of this data over, right? So in order to do that, it's a volume manager. Volume stack. Volumes is equal to volume manager. We pull it out of the volume manager. Instance.stack, yes. Okay. And then what we want is our custom post screen tint. So custom post screen tint, CPST, I guess. And then now we can go to our volumes and think of it as a get component. And we're just going to get this. So we're pulling it out of our current volume stack, right? So that would be out of this one. We're pulling this piece out. Now that we have CPST, now we have, you know, if it's active, we have all of this data here. If this is active, so that means only when it's active, then we actually do our screen blit. So first we need to set up our material. So if you recall here in our material, we have overlay color and intensity. So let's go ahead and set those two up. So we'll set color. We need to give it a overlay color. You know what? I'm just going to call this tint data. It's a little bit, makes more sense. Tint color. Then do the same thing for set float. But instead of overlay color, we're going to set intensity. Also, we're going to do our two blits, right? We need to blit from the source to the tint and then tint back to the source. We always did graphics.blit, but now we need to use a blit with a command buffer. Because we just kind of tells us which buffer to do our blit to. So, and then it does data goes from source to destination, right? So source would be our SRC, destination, tint, and what material to use, and what pass, zero. And then we want to blit back from tint to source. And we don't need material at that point. Here, we don't need this guy anymore. So the last thing we need to do for our execute to run is we need to run this thing called context.execute command buffer. And which command buffer to execute is this one. And then we need to actually release our command buffer. So command buffer pool.release this. Let's try this for now, but it might actually cause a bit of an error here because I can see this tint not being released. This is probably why we needed this tint ID. All right, looks like we have to actually create a temporary render texture here for our tint ID, for our tint. All right, in that case, then here we'll do our command get temporary render texture. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to create a render texture based off of what is the default. So the default would be whatever is coming from camera data. So camera data also has additional data that we might need. Camera target descriptor, render texture descriptor. Okay, and then here we'll pass in that, and then it needs a filter mode, so bilinear works, I guess. And then here now we're releasing that temporary, that tint ID as well. Okay, great, finally. Awesome, as you can see, it's actually tinting the screen directly. It can bloom out of order, we can change the color. So this is actually working as expected. Cool, so yeah, all that was missing was that temporary, we needed to do a temporary and release temporary. So yeah, that is actually it for this video. I know this was a little bit complicated and a little bit boring, but I think it is also extremely necessary because this will be like the forefront which we need in order to create future post effects. We can now go in here, like before, do the blitz that how we want. We can do based on the shader that we want to create ourselves, and then kind of just do our own thing and start creating effects this way. I think it's pretty cool that now we can add on to the URP pretty simply, not too complicated. But yeah, I hope this has been helpful for some of you guys.